is how to play the game! Since you have time to readjust to, being, you know, living alone and being single, do you ever miss living with someone? And what do you miss the most? I'm not talking about, like, personal stuff of your relationship, but maybe the general benefits of living with someone else. I know you said it doesn't bother you to live alone, but you lived with your ex for a couple years, so you had time with both. No, it's true. Listen, there's positives and negatives to both living alone or living with someone, all right? Well, for me, the biggest things that are negatives right now, all right, is number one, I'm responsible for everything. I have no one to lean on, no one to help me with everything. I'm talking finances, chores, you know, basically everything around the house is me, me, me. And it was one thing when I lived in Connecticut and I had this small condo and it wasn't a big deal. I have a big house, you know, so to remember, oh, I gotta clean, I gotta water the plants, I gotta wash the clothes, I gotta do this, I gotta pay all the bills, I gotta do that, you know, it's just constant every day behind the scenes when I'm not streaming or I'm not working, there's shit to do. In particular, the one thing, honestly, that's changed the most is cooking and meals. Because the way it used to work was I would be streaming, and then when I ended my first stream, dinner would be ready. You know, my ex would cook for us, and she was a good cook, so we'd go and eat together our dinner.
And clean up together.
So, you know, it would be an hour of prep and everything and cooking in the kitchen, and then as soon as I was done with stream, boom, we could eat and clean up, and I actually had some time between streams to relax. Not anymore, so I'll give you some perspective. Right now, I'm streaming Ask the King. As soon as I'm done streaming Ask the King, I have to upload these videos and put timestamps during all the questions and stuff during the show, which takes a while. It takes like a half an hour or longer. Then I gotta upload more videos to DSP Gaming. Then when I'm finally done with all that, I have to run downstairs. I'm making pasta for dinner tonight. So I have to boil the water, which takes like 15 minutes. Then I have to cook the pasta, which takes like 15 minutes. Then I have to do the sauce and combine it and everything. So you're talking about 45 minutes of prep before I even get to eat. Then I gotta eat quick. Oh, now I gotta clean up, so I gotta wash dishes, I gotta put everything away, then I gotta fucking get everything together for the second stream. And that's, you know, a matter of like 2 hours. So it's like this. My days, I'm bouncing boom, boom, boom from thing to thing to thing, while it used to be I had at least a little bit of kind of time, relaxation time and stuff in between because the responsibilities were shared. That's really one of the biggest negatives, okay? It is what it is, you know, living together versus being single. I mean, there's other benefits too because I'm single.
I am the master of my destiny 100%. It's not like,
you know, I have someone living with me who needs to be asleep at this certain time, and needs to be awake at this certain time, and needs the car at this certain time. You know, any time I have freedom to stream as late as I want, I have the freedom to do stuff. Now, keep in mind, I have to keep that within my own limitations. When I live with my girlfriend, my ex-girlfriend, it was more about, okay, well, we have plans to do stuff outside of when I'm streaming, so I have to limit myself so we have time to do that stuff. Versus now, it's like, now I have to be more careful that I don't talk too long or stream too long and hurt my voice or not get enough rest, and now I'm all, you know, tired or whatever for my own health purposes. So it's different. It's, you know, definitely a different kind of a situation there. The final question that Vera asked, have you ever had a near-death experience? If you're comfortable sharing what happened, no. The closest I ever came to dying was my car accident in high school, because that was very close. I mean, the door impacted to right here, and the only thing that saved my life was the airbag, because the airbag didn't deploy and basically push my face this direction, because it did burn the whole side of my face, the airbag, but if it didn't, the door would have impacted my head and I'd be dead. But that's the closest I ever came, you know, to dying, but I never had, like, a near-death experience or anything like that, where people say, oh, I was out of body, or, you know what I mean? Like, there's all these different things that people say. My life flashed before my eyes. No, that didn't happen. It didn't happen. These next few questions are from Nick, Nick2440. First question is, can you explain what you mean when you say you want to put your debt into your mortgage? How does that work? This is a very financial question. Some of you might not care, but right now, I have equity in this house, right now. What I paid for this house when I bought it, was far less than what the house is worth right now. Now, what that means is that I have what's considered equity. I have some value in the house. Even though there's a mortgage on it, there's some value. So what I could look to do is refinance my mortgage on this home, and it's going to increase the amount of debt in the mortgage, but what I could do is take some of the other debt that I have, like, for example, some of the credit cards that I have, and wrap them into the mortgage at a much lower interest rate than what I'm paying on the credit cards, okay? And what that would do is it would reduce my total monthly payments that I have to pay for everything, and it would actually help my credit score, because when you have credit card debt, that's seen as bad debt, and that hurts your credit score. Mortgages actually is seen as good debt, because it's an installment loan, kind of. It's not what they call oh God, not rotating debt. I can't, there's a word for it. You know, credit card is considered debt on debt because every month it recalculates the amount of money you owe and generates interest. The mortgage, you agreed to pay a certain amount of interest on your mortgage at, you know, if you have a fixed rate mortgage like I do, when you closed, and therefore you're only going to pay that certain amount of interest over time. It's considered good debt, versus the credit card could just go like this and keep going up and up and up every month. And if you just make minimum payments on a credit card, you may never pay it off, or it could take like 30, 40 years to pay off a credit card. Revolving debt. Thank you, Oaks Fin Mojo. Revolving, that's the word I was looking for. So, optimally, what I would like is if I could stay in this home for, like, say, you know, 3 more years, hopefully the home value will continue to increase. This year, I actually found out it stayed the same. But in this part of the country, home values are actually going up. So if I could stay here for, like, 2-3 more years, and the home value goes up even more, and as I'm slowly paying down all my other debts, hopefully I could refinance the house, excuse me. I can refinance the house and get some of that terrible revolving debt into the mortgage, and it'll help me out tremendously. Lower monthly payments and better credit score. There you go. Second question, how do you manage to do gameplay every day without getting burnt out? Well, I mean, the thing is, it's not, it would be one thing if, like, I was doing the same kind of gameplay every day. Like, if I'm, I'll be honest, if I was one of these guys, I only play first-person shooters, so I gotta play Call of Duty every day. I only play fighting games, so I have to play whatever the hot fighting game is right now, and that's all I do is fighting games. I would be burnt out. 100%, I'll tell you, I would be. But because I play such a wide variety of games, that's why I don't really get burnt out. It allows me to stay fresh and not get tired of what I do for a living. Just to give you an example, think about this week. I played Sonic Mania, an old-school 2D platformer. I played Agents of Mayhem, a kind of generic, grindy third-person shooter. I played Uncharted The Lost Legacy, a... I almost knocked all my papers off my desk. A, you know, platforming, adventuring, parkour, with a little bit of gunplay-style game with amazing graphics and a good narrative, right? Tonight, I'll be playing, Danganronpa 2, a visual novel, right? Tomorrow, I'll be playing Call of Duty World War II Beta, which is a freaking totally... See what I mean? In 1 week, I'm doing such a wide variety of stuff. It's hard. I wouldn't get burnt out. If I was doing the same thing every day, yeah. And I'll be honest, there are some times when if I am doing the same style of game consistently for a long period of time, I do kind of get burnt out. That's why, you know, earlier this year, I played Dark Souls 1, did a redemption run. Then, I played the Dark Souls 3 DLC. I also played Neo. And then during the summer, I did a Dark Souls 2... Scholar of the First Sin run, where I did a totally different build than the first time I did, my original Dark Souls 2 run. I do not want to play any games like that anytime soon. I've played way too much of that style of game this year, alright? And seriously, I'm just, like, so burnt out from it that I gotta stay away from it. I know right now, if a new Dark Souls-esque game were to come out and I were to play it, I would rage and I would be frustrated, I would be burnt out on it. That's why I'm happy with this hardcore gaming season. It's completely different styles of games that are coming out. So, that's the difference here is that, you know,
why don't I get burnt out? Because I diversify myself to doing many different things.
What do you think has been your best and worst year on YouTube? I mean, see, that's completely subjective. Because what do you consider good or bad? Is it good with the quality of the content that I put out on YouTube? Is it financially how I did? You know, some people argue that years like 2010 or 2011 were my best years on YouTube. Some people right now never watched my original stuff, and they like the stuff I'm doing now. You know what I mean? Like, some people are saying that since I started, the more emphasis on live streams, that my content's been completely reinvigorated, and all the stuff I'm doing now is better than the past 3 to 4 years. So, it's very subjective, and you're asking me, honestly, I don't think about it. I don't sit here and reminisce and say, man, this year was my best year, and this year was my worst year, or anything like that. I just keep pushing forward.
I'm more about looking forward than looking back.
That's the kind of person I've always been. So, for me, I can't even honestly answer your question because if you had specific criteria, like, what was your best year financially on YouTube? Okay, I could sit down and look at the numbers and say it was this year. Not this year, but, you know, it was this specific year, pointing to the past. But just the generalized question, I can't answer, okay? Your last question, do you think it was a mistake moving to Washington after everything that happened in the last few years? No, and I've answered this question a million times. You must not have been paying attention. No, moving to Washington was a great choice. It got me out of a condo where, for my health purposes, was horrible for me. The condo, number one, was way too expensive taxes-wise and everything I was doing there. I was paying so many extra taxes living in Connecticut just because I lived in fucking Connecticut and operated the business out of Connecticut. I'm talking a ridiculous amount of money, like thousands upon thousands of dollars of taxes a year going to the state of Connecticut. And by the way, they didn't do anything with that fucking money that did anything good. They just fucking blew it because the actual government in Connecticut is absolutely fucking terrible and falling apart at the seams. The internet was far worse in Connecticut. Remember how many internet problems I had when I lived in Connecticut? At least twice a year, I'd have like a fucking week where my internet would be down, wouldn't be working, and fucking stupid Optimum Online couldn't figure out what the problem was, could never resolve the issues. It was awful for the business. I couldn't do as much. I couldn't have a nice office like this with soundproofing and everything. Just look, the visual quality and the audio quality of the stuff I used to do before I moved to Washington was way worse. But also, physically, my health, all right, my health is better. Like, back then, I had a back injury. My back injury was really bad, and because of things like, for example, the weather, it'd be super-duper fucking humid and hot in the summer, then we'd have ice and snow in the winter, and even though I had a bad back, I had to shovel snow to get my car out and shit. It just wasn't good, and I would re-injure my back constantly and everything. Now things are way different. Like, because I live in a moderate climate, I don't have these kind of risks or threats anymore. My back is basically much, much better now. Now, of course, there's a whole other can of worms. My throat and stuff gets fucked up. It still used to get fucked up in Connecticut, too, but overall,
for the business,
the quality of stuff I put out, and also for my personal physical health, all right, things are better right now. Now, overall, yeah, things are kind of fucked financially and stuff like that. Financially, there's some problems. Financially, sadly, I am in a kind of a bind. There's situations where, you know, right now my finances aren't going so well, and hopefully I can bounce back from that. You know, hopefully I'll be able to eventually get out of that situation, and I'll be able to, you know, make things better. But for right now, overall, there's a lot of positives weighed in with, you know, this financial negative, and hopefully I can get past the financial negative, all right?
I prefer a penne. Easy to eat. Phil's a faggot. Phil's fat. Phil's a loser. Phil's a beggar. All right, I'm not dead, but I swear to God, I wish I fucking was.